Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our sixth and final student environmental series presentation. My computer has
this. Good morning, everyone. Welcome.
So my presentation is just loading. While that's happening, I just want to introduce myself. My name is Laura, and I will be going through this presentation with you. So I am joining you from Edmonton, Alberta, and I want to start off by acknowledging the people who have been caretakers of this land that we are all on today for millennia, and the numerous Indigenous groups that have lived and still live, work, and play on our lands today. Even though we can't be here together today, I do want us all to take a moment to acknowledge the history and knowledge of the peoples who have cared for and loved the land that we are on today. So I hope we can take this concept of respect for the land as we explore the topics of environmental chemistry and especially air and water quality, and take that forward into an idea of environmental stewardship. So I am, as I said, in Edmonton, which is traditionally known as the Miskwichi-Waskahegan, on Treaty 6 territory, which is the traditional lands of the Cree, Soto, Blackfoot, Dene, and Nakota Sioux peoples. And this is also part of Métis Region 4 as well. So we are here, again, on our last student environmental series presentation, which is really, really exciting. I have just a couple things to get us started. So you'll notice that there is a question and answer URL that is on the slide, you can see. And also, if you're joining on YouTube Live, you can actually access that from the link in the description. So this will be the best place for you to post any questions that you have as we go through this webinar, and I will be checking it periodically. If you are joining on Zoom, you can use the chat in Zoom as well. So today we are going to be talking about air and water quality, but why? Why do we even care about air and water quality in the first place? So I know for myself, I love to play outside. So I think it's really important for us to know how healthy our air is and how healthy our water is, especially if we're spending a lot of time in it. The reason for that is that both air and water can affect our health. So we need to know how that effect can happen. And I'll throw this one in too. I think nature is absolutely beautiful, and we have an inherent responsibility to make sure it remains healthy, not only for ourselves and for other humans, but also for the plants and animals that make it their home. So we're going to explore our responsibility being stewards or caretakers of our water and our air. And I think the first way that we can ensure that we are doing this is just seeing where those pollutants are even coming from and what those pollutants are. So I'm going to put up this slide here and put it out to all of you who are watching. What actually pollutes our air and water? So looking at this image, what are some of the sources of air and water pollution that you can see? If you want, feel free to put them in that Google Slides Q&A, and I can take some answers there. Also, I want to mention that this is a pretty typical landscape in Alberta. So in the background, you can see that there's a pretty big city, something like maybe Edmonton or Calgary. There's farming, forestry, and oil and gas extraction taking place outside of the city, as well as some components of a sample neighborhood in the foreground, which probably look pretty familiar to you. So many ways in which our everyday life can add sources of pollution to the air and water. And I'll just see if anyone has come up with any. Don't see any yet. So I can start my big reveal and start going through some of the ones that I have thought of. So as we go through these, you might hear of some compounds, some chemicals that you haven't heard of before. That's totally okay. I just think it's really important for us to know exactly what it is that's in our environment for us to understand it better. Oh, I'm seeing cars, forest fires. Those are awesome examples. Thank you. Thank you for those who are putting those in. So forest fires is actually the first one I wanted to point out. So up in the top right corner, you'll see that there's a forest fire. And one of the main things that forest fires contribute is particulate matter. So particulate matter are really, really tiny pieces of either solids or liquids that are airborne. So usually they are formed as the result of a chemical or physical reaction. And in this case, and often, it is because of combustion or burning. So you'll see that there's a little 2.5 next to the particulate matter. So that just means that that particulate matter is 2.5 microns in size or smaller. So that is really tiny and really hard to actually understand how big it is. So let's take a look at this. So if you look at the width of your hair, pretty small in itself, well, PM2.5 particles are 1/20th the width of a typical human hair. So they are quite tiny. They're the red balls that you can see on that, on the photo there, okay? And then PM10 are also particles that we can inhale, but so they can still enter our lungs, but they are a little bit larger. So they're about the fifth of the size of a hair. The problem with particulate matter is that it can get all the way into the alveoli or the air sacs in our lungs, which is where the oxygen goes from the air that we inhale into our blood. So if we get a lot of this teeny tiny particulate matter into our alveoli and into our lungs, it can kind of clog it up and it can mean that we can't quite get enough oxygen from the air into our blood. So that's one of the reasons why we care about the particles that are in the air. All right, let's see our next one. So the next one we're gonna look at is sulfur dioxide. So sulfur dioxide is formed from sulfur in raw materials, especially when we burn it. So those raw materials are generally our fossil fuels because fossil fuels are naturally quite high in sulfur. So when it goes into the air, it can combine with water vapor and it can actually cause acid rain. That's why you'll notice that on the screen there, there's a little water droplet that has the chemicals acid rain written in it. So as we go through these examples, the chemicals that are put into the clouds, those are air pollutants. And then if I add a water droplet on it as well, that means that water can be polluted by that as well. So sulfur dioxide can come back down into our water system through that acid rain, which is a bit of a problem. We're gonna talk about how industries have maybe started fixing some of these problems a little bit later. So don't worry, even though that is a cause, it's not a hopeless situation, don't worry. So next we have carbon monoxide. So this can come from the cars that were mentioned as one of the sources earlier by one of you. So when we have incomplete combustion in gasoline engines, we can get carbon monoxide coming out into the air. And carbon monoxide is colorless, tasteless, and odorless. So it can be really dangerous because you don't even necessarily know that you have a lot of it around. So that's why we have carbon monoxide monitors inside of our homes, because we need to make sure that we are monitoring for it in our homes so that it doesn't make us sick. But it can also be a problem out in the environment as well. So car exhaust, regardless of whether you can see the exhaust coming out of a car or not, if it is a gasoline engine, there is some carbon monoxide coming out of there, as well as this other, this next pollutant there at the bottom called nitrogen dioxide. So nitrogen dioxide is highly reactive. It's a reddish brown gas, though we don't usually see it in high enough concentrations to see the red and brown. And it results from the combustion of fuels as well. You'll notice I put up another chemical there near the top called VOCs. So VOCs are volatile organic compounds, and they actually come from things like paints, cleaning supplies, and aerosols. They can also come from natural sources such as plants. So volatile organic compounds, along with many of these other compounds that we're talking about, they exist naturally in our environment. It's just the fact that human activities can increase their concentrations in the environment to something that's not healthy for either humans or for the environment either. So the interesting thing about those VOCs and nitrous oxides, so the NOx that you see on the photo now, is that they can actually go through a chemical reaction with each other when there's enough heat and sunlight to produce ozone. So when the conditions are right, these two pollutants can come together and make ozone. You may be thinking, hooray, I've heard about holes in our ozone layer. This is an awesome thing, right? Unfortunately not, because this form of ozone is can be dangerous just because of where it is. So ozone is colorless, and it's highly irritating to our breathing and to our eyes. And when it's at ground level, as it is when those nitrous oxides and volatile organic compounds combine, it's right here where we're breathing. So that's the problem. It's still the exact same compound as up in the atmosphere that is keeping those UV rays or kind of filtering out those UV rays, which is good for humans. But when it's at ground level, not super great for our breathing. So therefore, it's considered a pollutant. The interesting thing about ozone, because it's produced in this reaction between nitrous oxides and volatile organic compounds, is that we often find it in places where there's high traffic. So I wanna show you this graph, and I wanna challenge you to try and interpret this graph before I give you the answer. So here is a graph of ozone concentration over a 2-week period. This measurement was taken in Fort McMurray, very close to the center of town. So right where people are living. And you'll see that there is a little bit of a pattern here. So I know the time is a little bit tricky to keep track of. So here, I'll add some lines here. So each of those red lines corresponds with 5 p.m. On each of the days. What do you notice about that ozone pattern? You might notice that the ozone tends to peak at that 5 p.m. time. Why would that be? Well, the thing is, at around 5 p.m., people tend to be driving home from work. So it makes sense that if there's higher traffic on the roads, then that ozone is also going to increase because there's all that nitrous oxide coming out of the car tailpipes and then is being formed into ozone. My guess during these 2 weeks is that the weather was probably quite sunny and warm, because that's the conditions that allow for nitrous oxides to really be produced in the most efficient way, I guess. So if we went back to September 2019, my guess would be that the weather during that time was quite warm and sunny. One of you can do a fact check on that for me to see if my hypothesis is correct. All right, a couple more to look at. So farming can also add both air and water pollutants into our environment. We have both the methane and ammonium, which can be added. And they can come from the fertilizers as well as from cow digestion. So when cows digest their food, they burp and fart out methane, which can then end up in our environment. In terms of the ammonium from fertilizers, it can end up out in the air, but then it can also end up in the water and then going down into groundwater or running off into surface water areas as well. So here you see the majority of the pollutants that we're going to be considering today and what those sources of pollution were. So if you have any questions about this or anything else as we go through this presentation, remember, don't hesitate to use that Q&A link that is shared at the top of the presentation, and I'll do my best to answer those. Okay, so now that we know a little bit about what is causing the pollution in our environment, I want to look at some case studies right here from Alberta to delve a little bit deeper. So this first one actually has to do with microplastics, which we didn't really talk about, but maybe you've heard about in your everyday life even. Microplastics are in the news quite a lot because they are very, very prevalent. So this was a study done by McEwen University, and they found that there were microplastics in all water bodies tested in and around Edmonton. Why do you think there would be so much microplastic in the water bodies in and around a big city like Edmonton? Where would those microplastics be coming from? Well, microplastics can come from any source of plastic, really. When we recycle plastic, we think that it magically disappears or it all is formed into a new form of plastic, and it's great for the environment, right? But plastics, they shred really, really tiny particles off of them all the time, and those end up maybe being washed down the drain, even maybe just out on the road, if you think about tires and the plastic of a tire kind of wearing away slowly. And they do end up in our water bodies. So even our clothing can cause microplastics to end up in the water. Because every time we wash our clothes, if you have something like a polyester or any other synthetic material, it can shed off tiny bits of plastic, which then end up in our water. So the next step that that these researchers want to take is to look at the levels of microplastics in some of our invertebrates. And the reason they might wanna do that is that invertebrates are those teeny tiny pond critters that you might have caught when you were doing wetland studies in the past, but they are kind of at the bottom of the food chain, if you think about it. So if these little invertebrates have microplastics within them, what happens when, say, a fish eats a whole bunch of these invertebrates? It will also end up with those microplastics inside of it. So it can actually result in maybe a lot of high concentration being concentrated in these animals higher up on the food chain. Now, another thing with water quality is that we can actually end up with pharmaceuticals, hormones, and antibiotics in our water. So in 2011, a U of A study found increased levels of feminization, which means that the proportion of females to males in the population was much higher on the female side than on the male side, and directly downstream from the Gold Bar wastewater treatment plant. Then when they studied it 2 kilometers further downstream, they didn't find that effect anymore. Why would that be? So you may have heard the solution to pollution is dilution phrase before. I don't think that's a solution to pollution at all, but it is something that happens. Once you get a pollutant out into the environment, it means that it doesn't just stay right where it's emitted. It spreads out. It spreads out in the air, it spreads out in the water, and eventually it gets to a low enough concentration that it doesn't have the severe effects that that it has when it's really, really localized or right where it's emitted. So with this, the thing with these hormones and medicines that go through our bodies is that they actually often end up going through our body, being flushed down the toilet, and then they aren't always cleaned up by wastewater treatment plants fully. So they can end up in our rivers as well. So those medicines and hormones are ending up in our river bodies, but they tend to be diluted once you get far away from the wastewater treatment plant. Does that mean that we don't need to worry about that? Well, not necessarily, because we're all connected in our watersheds. So if you tuned in a couple of weeks ago to the water presentation, you would have heard a lot about watersheds and some of the water quality challenges that are associated with water in Alberta. So I'm not going to go into too much detail about that because you can go back to that presentation on our YouTube channel if you're interested. But I do want to go through some of these, this concept of a watershed and what that actually means for what we're putting into the water. So in Alberta, we have 7 watersheds. So assuming you're joining us from Alberta, you're going to be in one of these 7 here. And they all drain to different, or they drain to various areas of the ocean as well. So at the top, you see our Hay River, Peace and Slave, and Athabasca River basins. They are fed by the Columbia Glacier. So the Columbia Glacier is the headwaters, and then all that water, or from that glacier, the water travels west through Alberta, and it actually continues north up to the Arctic Ocean. So let's think about a city that is within that area. So for example, Fort McMurray. I used to live in Fort McMurray. I know that Fort McMurray is in the Athabasca River Basin. So anything that happens in Fort McMurray or any of the chemicals or anything else that might end up in the water there, it is going to affect everyone downstream all the way up to the Arctic Ocean. So yes, maybe that any of the pollutants or medicines or hormones that end up in the water will get more diluted, but they are going to continue all the way down the river, all the way up to the Arctic Ocean, which means that there's a lot of communities along the way that are going to be connected by whatever is happening upstream of them. Now let's take a look here, or down south to the Bow Glacier and the Bow River. So the Bow Glacier feeds the Bow River, and the Saskatchewan Glacier feeds the North Saskatchewan River, which goes right through Edmonton here. And those head all the way out to Hudson's Bay. So going back to that example of the medicines at the Gold Bar Water Treatment Plant, which is here in Edmonton, those medicines and hormones are gonna end up affecting the communities all through Saskatchewan and Manitoba and then into the Hudson Bay area as well. And then finally, we have our Milk River Basin at the bottom, which actually goes all the way down to the Gulf of Mexico. So even though things get diluted when they end up in water, it is really important to remember that there are other communities downstream which will or may be affected by whatever we do here. And similarly to watersheds, there's actually something called an airshed as well. So airsheds, you can see the airsheds of Alberta split up here. These are associations that monitor the air in these specific areas. And then so we don't actually have all of Alberta covered by airshed associations. Does that mean that these blank areas on the map are not part of an airshed at all? Of course not, because I've noticed at least that there aren't too many walls between, say, between Edmonton and Calgary that say, okay, you're entering a new airshed, have to open up my plexiglass door and walk through. That's not how it works. This is just human created boundaries that allow for monitoring to take place. But air is going to move wherever it pleases because it moves quite easily. So an example of that is wildfires, which you've probably experienced at some point if you've spent summers in Alberta. So here is a map of, or an image showing the distribution of smoke from the high level fires in May of 2019, so a year and a half ago. So that black star on the map is where high level is and where the fires were actually taking place. Now, the red area is quite high concentrations of smoke, and then yellow is a little bit less and green is quite light. You'll notice that the smoke from that high level fire did travel all the way to Newfoundland at a concentration or a thickness that was enough to even be noticed. So regardless of the fact that that smoke moved from airshed to airshed, it still continued on west following the wind currents and affected people east of us here in Alberta. So wildfires are actually one of the big ways that air quality can be affected, especially here in North America. And it's actually the main reason why our air quality health index might increase or show poorer air quality when, especially in the summer. So air quality is the degree to which our air is pollution-free and how healthy the air is for us to breathe. So if you look outside right now, if you had to guess, what do you think the air quality is today? Is it pretty good or is it quite poor? To help with actually quantifying this, these indexes called the Air Quality Health Index have been developed so that there's actually a number scale. So the AQHI is calculated based on measurements of various pollutants. In for the national AQHI, it measures ozone, particulate matter, and nitrous oxides, and then does a calculation to figure out how big of a risk to human health it is. And then in Alberta, we've added a couple of other pollutants that are kind of locally relevant. So depending on where you're looking at AQHI, it might be measured in a slightly different way, but it does give us an idea of how healthy the air is or how risky the air is, I suppose. So I see that someone responded that they bet the air quality today is very good. And here in Edmonton, I'm looking out. I don't see smog. I don't see smoke in the air. So I would agree. It seems pretty good. So that means that it's pretty low risk, or I'm guessing that it's pretty low risk to be outside. Now, I actually checked the AQHI website, and that is the case. The AQHI here in Edmonton is between a 3 and a 4 based on the calculations at the different monitoring stations in the area. So that means that it's very low, maybe getting into moderate risk, but pretty good to be outside. So maybe you've remembered some days when you've had to have an indoor recess, even though it's nice and sunny outside, it's warm out, and you can't figure out why. Well, when the AQHI gets above 7, it can cause a high enough risk to students or and also adults, anyone in the public, that it's better to stay inside and not exert yourself too much with too much activity. So we can actually check the AQHI in our weather forecasts, and it can help us decide whether to spend a lot of time outside or kind of hunker down inside instead. So here is a picture of the map that you would see if you went to the AQHI Alberta map. So it will show all the monitoring stations across the province, and then you can see real-time data from there, as well as predictions for the following day as well. So an example of how air quality AQHI can be measured and where we've seen big spikes in AQHI. I'm going to take us back to May 2016 when the large wildfire took place in Fort McMurray. So this graph is actually showing particulate matter, remember, which are those tiny airborne particles that can get into our lungs. And at the beginning of May here, you can see that the amount of particulate matter in the air really spiked. Okay. So that is because there was a lot of combustion, a lot of burning going on, a lot of soot being released, and it caused the particulate matter to spike. And then it stayed high for a lot of that summer, especially at the beginning when the fire was quite strong. So at this point, when the particulate matter spiked like this, the AQHI actually went over 300. Remember, on that last slide, we saw the scale usually goes from 1 to 10, and anything over 10 is quite high risk. Well, in Fort McMurray, at the time of this wildfire, we were over 300 because there was so much particulate matter, especially in the air. So, yeah, really helpful to have that tool to be able to measure the risk of the air around us to make sure that we can keep ourselves healthy. Now, we can also look at water quality monitoring. It's done by Environment and Parks here in Alberta, as well as a variety of partners, partner groups that exist in our province. So they monitor the water to ensure safe drinking water. They monitor for pathogens in the water that might make you sick or itchy if you swim or enter the water. Again, in that water presentation from a couple weeks ago, I believe Andre talked a little bit about swimmer's itch. So if you're interested in that, go check that out. And also they monitor the water for the health of the environment as well. So an example of why water quality might be important is looking at fish in the Little Smoky River and its tributaries. So they actually have some consumption limits of these fish, so the mountain whitefish and the burbot, because of, well, for some reason. Why do you think they might have consumption limits on some of these different types of fish? I'll let you think about that for a moment. So if you are an avid fisher, this is one of the things that you can take a look at before you go out fishing to make sure that there aren't consumption limits in the area that you're fishing in. And really the main reason for that is to keep you healthy. So these fish in this area have been found to have high amounts of mercury in their livers and in their fatty tissue. And the reason why mercury can be a problem is kind of like we were talking about the microplastics in the invertebrates, is that because these fish are kind of higher up on the food chain, they eat other organisms that have mercury in them, and then it accumulates within their tissues, in the fish tissues. And that process is called bioaccumulation. So the higher up an animal is on the food chain, the more of these chemicals it might end up with in its body as well. And I see that microplastics and harmful chemicals were some of the ideas that you had. So absolutely perfect. That is exactly what we are considering here. And again, in this case, specifically mercury. And mainly it's coming from human sources, such as burning coal and also burning waste that might release methyl mercury. And this ends up in water bodies through runoff, for example, and it's really easily absorbed by the fish. So it's the mercury in the air isn't a problem. It's more of a problem once it's converted into the methyl mercury, which ends up in the water system as well. And then the dioxins and furans, which you can see at the top of the screen there as well, they are toxic airborne substances from burning organics and wastewater discharges from industrial sites. So the largest source of those is burning of municipal and medical waste. So in Canada, also from producing iron and steel and burning other fuels as well. So they also work their way up the food chain and can be stored in the body. So something to keep in mind as we take things from the environment, because they can have toxins within them. And they can also come from natural sources. So volcanoes can emit some of these toxins as well. So just because something is a chemical doesn't mean that it can't come from a natural source. The main issue with some of these chemicals and pollutants is that humans are adding even more to the environment than would naturally be there. And then that can be the main challenge. And that's also the part that we can do something about. So that's what we really want to focus on. My final example, I want to look at emissions in our oil sands region, specifically the Athabasca oil sands, which is in and around Fort McMurray. It's our biggest oil sands area, has the highest amount of surface mining, and there's a lot of production of oil, or a lot of refining and upgrading of the oil that happens there, which means that sulfur can actually be emitted through these processes. So thinking back to that map that we looked at the very beginning of the presentation, the main source of sulfur is industrial processes, especially in fossil fuels, which are naturally high in sulfur. So let's look at this graph, and I'm going to show you a series of graphs to kind of see what might be happening up in that area. So this first graph shows how sulfur emissions at an oil sand site have changed year to year. So for the most part, other than this higher blip in 2004, they've remained pretty level, correct? So we can also look at how much oil has been produced by the oil sands area. So that big green wedge is the Athabasca oil sands, which is the Fort McMurray area, which is where these sulfur measurements were taken as well. So this graph starts at 2007, the top one showing the oil sands production. What do you think happens to sulfur emissions if our oil sands production is increasing? I'll give you a moment to think about that. So we don't know what the oil sands production looked like before 2007, because this graph starts at 2007. But based on what you know about where sulfur comes from, what do you think might be the story from 2008 onward when we look at our sulfur emissions? See if there's any brave people out there. So, if you're a little confused and unsure, that's totally okay. My guess would be that the sulfur emissions would start increasing, and because the oil sands production is increasing as well. But let's take a look at the story. Turns out that the sulfur emissions actually stay pretty steady, even though the oil sands production is increasing. Now, why would that be? I would have expected the emissions to get higher, but just because our production is increasing doesn't mean that there's not technology and innovations that are also happening to try and reduce our negative impacts on the environment. So one of the things that is taking place, especially in oil sands production, is sulfur scrubbers. So by putting these scrubbers into the chimneys that come off of these plants, they can actually take the sulfur out of the emissions that would end up in the air and create solid blocks of sulfur out of it. So the photo on the screen is actually one of these solid blocks of sulfur that are piled up in and around the oil sands plants, because it's so they've taken it out of the air and are storing it as a solid. Still a bit of a problem. We need to figure out what to do with that solid, but at least it's not polluting the air. Some of the other innovations that are helping our air quality specifically have to do with carbon capture. So we didn't talk much about carbon, but when we burn fossil fuels, we do release carbon dioxide, which is a very, very potent greenhouse gas. So there are some technologies out there that are being developed to actually take that carbon out of the air and make something useful out of it. So the Carbon X on the left side of your screen there, they actually take the carbon out of the air and then they produce potash out of it. And they can actually make soap out of that potash that they are taking out of the air. So this is an Alberta-based company. So maybe if you're looking for some climate-friendly local Christmas gifts, you can look into some Carbon X soaps. The CO2 pipeline is from the Shell Quest carbon capture and storage facility. So it's in Fort Saskatchewan, just outside Edmonton here. And they are taking carbon out of the air from the, or out of the emissions from the Shell bitumen upgrader. And they are taking out an equivalent of 1 million cars worth of carbon out of the air a yearly. So doing a pretty good job of reducing carbon emissions there. There's also electric buses as here in Edmonton. 40 were purchased and a few of them went on the road in August of 2020, which is pretty cool. So that's reducing our fossil fuel burning generated carbon emissions as well. And then something that we can do in our own homes is looking for these energy efficient options, which reduce the amount of electricity that is needed, because where does Alberta's electricity come from? Mainly from burning natural gas, which again does produce a lot of carbon. So lots of innovations in the works as well. Now, one last thing I want to talk about before I wrap up for the day is about community-based monitoring. So far we've talked a lot about the science of monitoring and ways of measuring in the environment. And I'm wondering, does that tell the whole story? Well, Indigenous knowledge can actually fill many gaps about these areas that are being monitored, as the history of that knowledge and of the people of that area reaches back thousands of years. So the way of seeing and learning about the world in Indigenous cultures is different from the way that I'm assuming many of us are most familiar with, which is the scientific method. So different information can be gathered by seeing the world around us in these different ways. Community-based monitoring does just that, tries to incorporate the Indigenous traditional knowledge of an area, as well as the scientific measurements and process that we can put into use. And then it kind of gives a more complete and total story, which I think is really awesome. Community-based monitoring also allows the communities themselves to direct the reasoning and the way in which the research is done, which can be incredibly important in ensuring that they are getting the information that they themselves want about their own traditional lands and communities as well. So there's a few examples of this happening in Alberta. So the first one is up on the screen there. It is the Peace Athabasca Delta Environmental Monitoring Project, or PADEMP, as you see. And it is it's a bunch of the different Indigenous groups from that area working with scientists and monitors to gather information about the water and traditional lands of their area. Also, Wood Buffalo Environmental Association is working with Indigenous communities around Fort McKay to look at the impact of air quality on the berries that are found on their traditional lands. So those berries are an important food source for the Indigenous peoples of that area and have traditionally been a food source. But now with the oil sands operations in the area, they want to look at if any of that, any of the pollutants that might be in the air, if it's going to affect the health of the berries, and then also if that could transfer to the health of humans as well. And finally, there is fish monitoring taking place in the Cold Lake area with the Cold Lake First Nations, so that they could know more about the populations of fish in that area. Something really interesting for any of you who might be interested in getting into monitoring. There's actually a community-based monitoring program at Keanu for Indigenous students to learn the scientific methods as well as the Indigenous land-based perspectives on monitoring as well. So something pretty cool to look into. Now, ways that you can get involved right now, citizen science, it's an opportunity for the public and students to get involved at a community level. So I'm going to give you a couple of examples here. The first one is the environmental DNA monitoring in water, which again, Andre talked about in that water presentation. So I suggest you take a look back at that if you're interested in more information. But here's Colin at St. Matthew's School in Calgary. And we, once in-person visits start up again, we'll be able to bring these machines into the classroom and show students the process of actually extracting that DNA from water samples, and then explain how that can be used for monitoring as well. And then Purple Air is an air monitoring program that is taking place at the community level. These are different sensors from the Alberta sensors, which I mentioned with the AQHI. But these sensors, you can possibly get one onto your school or onto your community league. I know in Edmonton, community leagues are being offered these sensors for free. So I'm actually going to meet with my community league this afternoon to get one put onto our building, which I'm really excited about. And in the photo there on top of the map, you can see the one that is installed at the Inside inside education office right here. So kind of just gives some more regional data about air quality. And you can look at any place across the world for what the air quality might be there as well. So definitely check it out if you're interested. Purple air is what you have to Google, and then you can take a look at air quality anywhere across the world. So what are some ways that you can positively affect air quality in your community? Just put in a couple thoughts into the Q&A because I would love to see what you think. But as I'm waiting for that to be populated, I'll share some of the thoughts that we gathered a couple weeks ago about how we can take care of our water quality. So we can make sure that our water is healthy by reducing the amount of water we use, by maybe taking shorter showers and using a rain barrel to collect rainwater to water our gardens instead of using hose. We can walk more and drive less so that we're putting less pollutants out into the roads as well. And we can reduce the use of pesticides on gardens and just do some weeding instead. That way those pesticides don't end up running off into our environment. So let's see. Oh, awesome. Someone says to take care of our air quality, so you could bike or walk to school. So that is an awesome idea. And a couple of my colleagues also mentioned that that would be a great way to take care of our air. So Julie and Andre both had that to say. Steve also says that you can just get a Tesla. So add that to your Christmas list. Maybe not possible for everyone to be able to get one of those. Use less electricity. Awesome. So then that means that we're putting, that there's less pollution being put out into the atmosphere because we're burning less natural gas. What else? We could maybe put idle-free signs around your school to make sure that cars aren't idling or running without moving, because that's a way that pollution is put into the air as well. Any others? My favorite thing is you could take something that you heard here today and you can tell someone something interesting about air quality here in Alberta, because the more we can get others to care about the topic, the more likely others are going to do something to take care of it as well. So that is just about all the time we have. So I want to thank you for participating in our final student environmental education series webinar of the fall. Stay tuned to our YouTube page if you have other, if you want to see other presentations as well. There's lots of videos on there, and there might be more coming in the new year. And before I sign off, I'll just double check to see if there are any questions. Oh, awesome. I see that there is one asking, how can we help with the microplastic problem? That is a really good question and a really tricky one as well, because plastics are they're in our life. We use them all the time. So one of the ways that we could maybe help with the microplastic problem is reduce the amount of plastics that we use. So in some ways, like our car tires are going to have plastics in them. There's not a whole lot we can do about it, but maybe we can choose what types of clothing we buy, try and buy natural fibers instead. Or maybe even with grocery bags, if you have your own reusable grocery bags, at least you're not throwing out these garbage bags all the time, which even though they get recycled, it can still shred some of that plastic into the environment. So the best way we can affect that problem is to reduce our use of plastics. I'm just scrolling through. I don't see any other questions right now. So thank you so much for joining me today. Thank you for joining us at these webinars this fall, and we look forward to seeing you again soon. All right.